These students at Ed W. Clark High School in Las Vegas, Nevada have gathered together to play the popular fighting game Super Smash Bros. Melee. Although this particular meeting may look small, they are actually a part of a much larger group, the esports community.
We end tonight in a virtual world of sports. Video gaming has gone professional, and the rising stars of the esports boom are making real money.
First of all, explain how you can make a profession out of this. How do they actually get paid?
So, okay, obviously there are different prize pots for different games, and they vary in size.
Electronic sports, or esports for short, are a form of competition in video games. Players, or teams, go at each other in a variety of different games ranging from first and third person shooters, to fighting games, all the way to online battle arenas. And those skilled sometimes took these games to a competitive level, competing at high stakes tournaments such as DreamHack, Intel Extreme Masters, and Evo, with a chance to win cash, glory, fame, and possibly women. The history of esports can be traced all the way back to the basic arcades. The first major video game competition was held in 1980, called the National Space Invaders Tournament. 10,000 people attended and established competitive gaming as a potential mainstream force. Later, in 1991, Street Fighter II was released to arcades, bringing a new generation of people back in to compete against one another. While previous competitions focused on who could hit the highest score, Street Fighter took a different approach, focusing on direct one-on-one combat versus another player, with the winner being whoever outplayed their opponent in the last match. In the late 90s, computer games such as Warcraft and Quake began to gain popularity. Finally, people were able to play others without having to leave their own living rooms using the power of the internet. And as the quality of internet improved, so did the growth of esports as a whole. The birth of what we now know as the modern esport began in South Korea. After the Asian financial crisis in 1997, broadband internet networks were built across the country, which gave birth to PC banks. Gaming hangouts filled with high-powered PCs, granting a good portion of the population access to good connections and capable machines. In what seems like an internet gaming boom, online competitions were shaping to be one of the early starts of today's competitive championships, with opportunities to be crowned best in the world on the line. Soon after, Korean television stations began to broadcast video games, with the first title being StarCraft II, which took up a majority of the airtime. Skilled StarCraft players quickly grew into celebrities, with top personalities and players being treated just like their top athletes.
그 길을 다니다 보면 저를 알아보시는 분들이 있는데 그럴 때마다 좀 뿌듯하고 더 잘해져서 더 유명해져서 이런 사람들이 많아졌으면 좋겠다라고 생각을 해요.
Despite this, the craze was mostly contained in Korea, with the rest of the world watching from the sidelines. When the popular broadcasting service Twitch.tv launched in 2011, everything changed. Suddenly, just like those Korean TV stations, anyone could stream games and get just as popular. Shortly after, multiplayer online battle arena games, or MOBAs, gained immense traction and popularity on Twitch and around the world.
Venus, the Swedes, they pull something out of the bag, and Venus is going to go down as well!
Oh no, Tidehunter!
But ask any of the kids here why they play, and the answer they give is simple.
It's pretty fun. It's kind of hard, though.
I just like playing in school.
It's fun, like, because you're, like, playing basketball and you can punch each other.
The inclusivity of esports makes them appealing to all kinds of people. In the arcades, anyone with a quarter can play against anyone else. Now, anyone with a computer or a gaming console can pick up a game and play with people all across the world. As technology continues to advance, with both internet speeds and computer hardware growing faster, esports will grow alongside with it. Modern game developers strive to make their titles esports ready, balancing their games around being played at the highest competitive level and including robust spectator modes. Having good netcode is a necessity for the success of any competitive game, something gamers in the 80s could have never imagined. The market for esports is primarily younger people, ranging from 10 to 30 years old, and is a market that is constantly evolving. People consume less media from the television and more online streaming services such as YouTube, Netflix, and Twitch. Live streaming has snuck its way in as a key part of gaming culture. Viewers can directly interact with streamers through text chat and can donate to them through the platform as well.
Currency thing? Or, I mean, what is it? I'm not sure. I mean, is it like some kind of currency thing? I'm not sure. I don't know. Is it some kind of currency thing? You know, who knows? I'm not sure.
These types of interactions are not possible with the television, making live streams the preferred form of media for gamers.
Not a big deal at all.
Even when events are broadcasted on TV, many opt for viewing the event on their computers or phones instead. There, they can interact with other fans of the game, rewind and pause easily, and carry it with them wherever there is Wi-Fi.
Let me say some shoutouts to some subs.
Top players have the potential to make six figures in their career between sponsorship salaries, livestream donations, and tournament winnings. The culture as a whole is incredibly player-focused, with the right type of player being able to influence how everyone else plays the game, coming up with new strategies and techniques for others to learn from and copy.
Playing against each other all day, we don't have to worry about any streams, we don't have to worry about any videos, like this is the roots of like competitive gaming right here, just trying to get better before the biggest tournament of the year. So I'm excited.
Esports training is often vigorous. Professionals often practice more than 40 hours a week around the time of a full-time job. In addition to practicing, they travel to events, market themselves as personalities, and figure out new ways to beat their opponents. Gaming houses are houses where a certain team resides, so they are always in close proximity of one another, practicing. Many have taken advantage of this live streaming their practice sessions, making more money in the process.
I'm overwhelmed with emotion right now. Like, it's amazing. So, I mean, we just finished Evolution, and every year it blows my mind that it keeps happening every year, and it keeps getting bigger like this, and just what happened this year was just the most amazing thing. I can't, like, it feels like a dream to me right now. I feel like I'm gonna wake up at any point in time.
Evolution, or Evo for short, is the largest fighting game tournament in the world. Hosted in Las Vegas, Nevada, the tournament attracts thousands of entrants and hundreds of thousands of viewers, broadcast on large channels such as ESPN and Disney.
You had a quarter and you put the quarter up, you are allowed to play with everybody else. And that really also led to the large diversity that we have here, because, you know, at an arcade I don't want to call it discrimination, but there was no discrimination. Like, you walked up with a quarter, you put it down, and you're gonna play. Well, we've already gone through one whole day of fighting games. This is day number two already. And we've had, like, this is where thousands and thousands of people show up from around the world. We had like over 80 countries represented here. Well, like, I just look around right now and I just see people everywhere. And all of us are here for the same reason, because we love these video games. We love these fighting games. You know, people plan their one vacation of the year to come to Evo because that's how big this is. And so when you come here and you get to hang out and be with all these people that share the same hobby, and then once we get to Sunday and we're all in the stadium and we're all watching and everyone's cheering at the same time for the same, everyone's watching the same thing and we're all so excited. Like, it's a feeling that you just don't get anywhere else. You know, there's an inside joke I get very emotional at Evos all the time, and that there's a reason for that. It's not like I'm playing it up or anything. Like, I legit get very emotional at these events because that's how much it means to me.
Look at this. This is impressive.
With just one glance, you can understand why the CEO of Allied Esports, Judd Hannigan, is a proud guy. You're looking at the first ever permanent esports arena on the Strip. It's going to host some of the biggest esports tournaments in the world, with prize money in the tens of thousands.
Now, with this obviously being the first comes the reward, but also some risk.
I think there's inherent risk in just about anything that's so new like this. There's not a lot of history. In many ways, we're blazing that path.
The Luxor's big gamble on the 30,000 square foot arena is the strongest evidence the lure of esports is too much to ignore.
The esports arena in Las Vegas recently opened in March of 2018, bringing a new type of gaming to the city of Sin. Located on the famous Las Vegas Strip, what the facility hopes to achieve was previously unprecedented. Although the business first began in Los Angeles, the growth of Vegas and its already existing status as the entertainment capital of the world made it an appealing spot to open. It marks a growing change in competitive video games being held in whatever cheap venue would be willing to host them into a powerhouse with entire businesses.
Good fight, man. GG, man. Oh my god. Let's
and look
go,
at that
baby.
Moment.
Let's go, baby.
Ladies and gentlemen, make some noise. Ninja wins the game.
Let's get it. The future of esports is looking very bright. A new genre of shooters, battle royales, featuring 100 players in a Hunger Games-esque arena in a fight for their lives, has risen in popularity as of recent, with a Las Vegas charity event based on the genre amounting to over $100,000 being donated to suicide prevention. The industry is estimated by many to reach a worth of $2 billion by 2020. Game developers are beginning to learn how to craft their products towards their audience, and many schools have begun teaching about competitive game design. The Overwatch League, hosted by Blizzard, is a league structured similar to that of actual sports, pulling players from the same cities in order to represent their region at the highest levels of play. Esports is rapidly becoming a billion-dollar industry, with big names such as Red Bull and Shaquille O'Neal pumping money into the scene, as well as technology brands such as Razer and Logitech heavily marketing their products towards these competitive gamers. The venture onto new platforms has proved to be interesting for esports. The popular collectible card game Hearthstone is available on mobile, and titles such as Clash Royale have seen recent success. Virtual reality looks to be promising, with shooters already having been developed for the game. However, VR esports is still a ways out from being mainstream, let alone included in tournaments.
Super. Oh, get out of here. Get out of here. He's going for it. He's going for it. Will he get the jump afterward? Here it is. Oh!
Esports has come a long way since the days of old arcades. From a Space Invaders tournament in the 80s to the growth of the internet and computer gaming in the 90s, all the way to million-dollar production events today, esports still shows no sign of slowing down now. And we're just getting started. Every tournament open to the public has more and more newcomers to the scene, giving those watching from afar an optimistic hope that the talent for gaming will continue to grow and grow. Who knows? Esports soon might become America's new favorite pastime.